Hello Year 7 and welcome to your last video of the year. We've got one more week worth of learning. I might put some other videos up during the 6 weeks holiday, but this is the last thing that's going to be on Google Classroom that you have to submit. So for the last couple of lessons, we've been looking at the Civil War, and at the end of last week's lesson, we saw that King Charles I had been beheaded, his army had lost, and he was no longer the King of England. So we are now going to look at who takes over and whether that person is a king or not. So you should be able to see my screen now. So our big question for today is, how should we remember Oliver Cromwell? Oliver Cromwell is the key person we're going to be looking at in today's lesson. So we've got some keywords here. I suggest once that you pause the video and write these down because they're going to help you throughout the lesson. So firstly, Parliament, one of our keywords from last lesson, that is politicians who are voted in by people to make decisions about the country. We still have a Parliament full of politicians today. Second one, Lord Protector. Now, when Cromwell takes over, he doesn't make himself king. He gives himself this other title of Lord Protector of England, Scotland and Ireland. We need to understand that. Puritan is number three, and that it was a type of Protestant Christian, a really, really strict type of religion. Number four, the Irish Rebellion was when Irish Catholics were fighting with the English for control of Ireland. And then finally, tolerant. That is when you are accepting of people with different beliefs to you. If you are tolerant, you accept others' beliefs. So as well as our big question, we also have to be able to answer by the end of the lesson, how did Cromwell's religion affect his time in charge? And should Cromwell's statue, which is in London, stay up or come down? There's a lot of debate at the minute about whether statues should be torn down or not because of things that the people have done in the past. And we're going to be joining in with that debate in today's lesson. And finally, our application of skills, we are doing an interpretation. An interpretation is when we look back at a person or an event and we try and think about what their life was like. Should we remember them positively? Should we remember them negatively? Or should we be somewhere in the middle? So this is Oliver Cromwell, our big person that we're meeting today. You can see from this portrait, it's difficult to focus to see exactly on there, but he was very warty. He had warts on his face, and he was actually really proud of this. He didn't want the people who painted his picture to get rid of any of the warts on his face. He wanted them to show him warts and all. You compare that to some of the kings and queens who've come before, people like Elizabeth I, who really carefully controlled what the portraits looked like because she wanted people to see that she was beautiful, even if the reality maybe wasn't as true. So Oliver Cromwell takes over because King Charles I was beheaded on the 30th of January 1649. The King's Royalist army had lost the English Civil War to the Parliamentarians, and that was the army that were led by Oliver Cromwell and another man who we will meet at the end of this slide. Oliver Cromwell was distantly related to Thomas Cromwell, who was King Henry VIII's advisor. You might remember him when we looked at the Reformation and the dissolution of the monasteries. He worked really closely with Henry VIII until Henry VIII had him killed. And Oliver Cromwell didn't come from wealthy stock all of his life. He'd actually been a very poor farmer before becoming a Member of Parliament in 1628, before joining one of these people who were voted in to make decisions on the country. And he sort of worked his way up, and when the Civil War began in 1642, Cromwell, along with another man called Thomas Fairfax, led the New Model Army. The New Model Army is this, we looked at it in our last lesson, this professional unit. You can see their uniform there. They were given pay, they were given uniform, and they were given training, and they led the parliamentarians to victory in the English Civil War. After Charles I's death, Cromwell decided he was not going to be king, maybe partly because of his religion. He didn't want to be seen as somebody particularly special. Instead, he gave himself the title Lord Protector of England, Scotland and Ireland. He was given that title in 1653. Now, although we've just said that he sort of didn't want to be seen as a king, he does start to act like a king, as we will see throughout this lesson. And also from some of the images, if you look at this here, it's very clear. Compare the size of him to the other people around him, compare like how close he is to heaven and things like that. He is very much being shown as a special leader, very similar to how we would see kings. And one of the ways that we remember Cromwell is for his success in battle. So he spent most of his time fighting in wars to make sure that he had control of England, Scotland and Ireland. And it would have been very, very difficult, very rare for a king of England to have control of Scotland and Ireland. In Ireland is somewhere we're going to particularly focus on because he was particularly vicious. And in Ireland, Cromwell is still seen as a very, very divisive figure, as somebody who a lot of people say was evil with his actions in Ireland. And he actually ended up killing over 600,000 Irish people. Not just him, his armies killed over 600,000 Irish people, which at that time was about 40% of the population. And part of the reason that he hated Ireland, or that he wanted to take control of Ireland and defeat the Irish rebellion, was because he didn't want Catholics to be in charge of the country. Irish is still today a majority Catholic country, and Cromwell was a very, very strict Puritan, as we're going to see on the next slide. And as a result, he hated Catholics, and because most Irish people were Catholic, that maybe explains why he was so vicious in his dealings over there. So as we've said, Cromwell was a Puritan, really strict type of Protestant. You can see this is the type of clothes that a Puritan would wear. And that word itself means pure soul. And when he became Lord Protector, he was so strict with his religion that he banned a number of activities, including the celebration of Christmas. So you weren't allowed to meet with your family. You weren't allowed to celebrate. You weren't even allowed to go to church on Christmas Day, because he thought that the celebration, the festival, had become too Catholic and become more about entertainment than it was about celebrating Jesus's birth. Now we'll look in the lesson at other things that Cromwell banned because of his strict Puritan beliefs. And then also Parliament. Now bear in mind, he was a member of Parliament before the Civil War. He also was led part of the Parliamentarian army. Okay, so you'd think that he would be want a really, really strong parliament, that he would want to work closely with people who had been voted in. But even though he had gone to war with Charles I and eventually chopped the head off Charles I for ignoring Parliament, Oliver Cromwell also ignored Parliament. He very rarely spoke to them. The rule was that he only had to speak to them once every 3 years. And he also, at one point, got rid of all of his politicians and he put in new ones who were nominated by the church. He said he wanted godly men, holy men, to make the decisions. And this was called the Parliament of Saints, because those politicians were supposed to be godly. And one of the members, this man here, had a very Puritan name. I love this figure. His name is Praise God Barebone. That's a very Puritan name that shows how strict they were with their religion. And some sources suggest, you think his name is odd, some sources suggest that he named his son, "Unless Jesus Christ had died for thee, thou hadst been damned." Barebone. Imagine trying to sing that when you're doing the happy birthday song. So Cromwell often ignores Parliament. Then we get to the Restoration. This is the last slide before you do some work. So even though Cromwell had turned down being King of England, he didn't want to be, he was a Lord Protector rather than being a king, he still acted like a king throughout his time in charge. And before he died, he insisted that his son, Richard, up here with the fantastic luscious blonde locks, would become the Lord Protector after him. So just like a king would pass on their crown to their eldest son, he said exactly the same as Lord Protector. So when Oliver Cromwell died of malaria in 1658, Richard Cromwell succeeded him, but he only lasted for 264 days before giving up his position. And the main reason that he gave up his position was because the English restored the monarchy. Restoring the monarchy means they brought back kings and queens. So Oliver Cromwell was when they'd moved away from kings and queens, but they decided after him and after a brief time with his son, they wanted king and queens back. And so they invited back Charles II, who was the son of the beheaded Charles I. And he had been king of Scotland, and he took charge of England as well in 1660. And we have had a king or queen ever since. So from this moment on, we have had a king or queen. So these are our comprehension questions then. So A, which army won the English Civil War? B, who was Oliver Cromwell's distant relative? I'll give you a clue. We looked at him when we looked at Henry VIII. C, what did Cromwell do before he became a member of Parliament? What job did he do? D, what was the name of the army that Cromwell led during the Civil War? E, other than Cromwell, who was the other leader of that army? F, Cromwell wasn't king. What was he called instead? G, what does Puritan mean? H, why did Cromwell ban Christmas? Give at least two reasons. I, why is it surprising that Cromwell ignored Parliament? J, who took over as Lord Protector after Cromwell's death? And K, what did England do in 1660? Okay, so answer those 10 questions or so. Hopefully you'll have paused the video in order to do so. Okay, your task two then is I've got a series of cards about Cromwell's time as Lord Protector. And what I want you to do is I want you to separate them into two sides of a table. I've put a table on the next slide for you. On one side, we're looking for evidence that Cromwell should be remembered positively. So positive things about Cromwell. And on the other side, we're looking for evidence that Cromwell should be remembered negatively. So let's give some examples then. Let's go with this one here. So as well as Christmas, Cromwell banned makeup, theatres, pubs and football. Puritans believe that they distracted people from concentrating on Jesus Christ. Now, you might have a different opinion to me, but if a king or a Lord Protector came in charge and said that they're going to ban football and pubs and theatres, not so bothered about makeup, then I would very much be putting them in the negative column. Okay, you might disagree, you might hate football and be completely on Cromwell's side, but I would say that is evidence that he should be remembered negatively. We've also got some interpretations that people have written about the people since they've died. So this is John Milton, a man who served under Cromwell's government, and he wrote that Cromwell had outstripped not only the achievements of our king, but even the legends of our heroes. You have taken upon yourself to rule three powerful nations. So there he's saying that he's more than a king, he is a legend and a hero. So that very much sounds like he should be remembered positively. That would be going on that side. And remember, you don't need to write the whole card out, you can just summarize it for us. Just do one more because I think it links in nicely with what we're going to talk about next. This one here. So when Charles II became king, Cromwell's body was dug up. Bear in mind that he's been Lord Protector, he's died peacefully, and then he's been buried. His body was dug up, he was hung, and then his head was put on a spike above Westminster Hall, where Charles I had been beheaded, and it remained on display on that spike for 26 years until a storm blew it off. Now, I would say that if you're putting somebody's head on a spike, that very much suggests that they should be remembered negatively. So that would be evidence to go on that side. And I can show you the beautiful Oliver Cromwell. You think he was ugly with his warts before he died. He's not looking very attractive here at all. But bear in mind, this is 350 years after he died. So it's maybe not a surprise that he's not looking in the best state. But yeah, part of his head has been preserved there, as we can see. So your final task of the lesson and of the year is a letter to our Prime Minister, Boris Johnson. So there is a statue of Oliver Cromwell, which stands outside the House of Parliament in London, and you can see it here. And we usually have statues of people that we admire. So if you think in Nottingham, we have a statue of Brian Clough, who was a Nottingham Forest manager, who won Forest the European Cup twice. So he is admired in Nottingham, and so we put a statue of him up. What I want you to do is I want you to use information from today's lesson to write a letter to our current Prime Minister telling him either why the Cromwell statue should come down, so you'd be focusing on some of the negative things that Cromwell did, or why the Cromwell statue should stay up. Okay, and I've got a sentence structure, sentence starters to help you there. You can use those, or you can completely do your own writing. You don't need to use those. But make sure you're giving evidence to back up your argument of why you think it should come down. And as we said at the start, there's a big big debate at the moment about statues of people that we have up across the country and whether actually they are deserving of our admiration, of our respect. And if we actually find out that they've done things that are wrong, like for Oliver Cromwell, yes, he did incredibly positive things. Yes, he took over, he was able to control England, Scotland and Ireland. You might put that on the positive side, which suggests his statue should stay up. He's also led to the deaths of 618,000 people, at least, in Ireland. And that's what, 40% of the population. So you can see how it is a debate as to whether the statue should stay up or come down. Okay, so all in all then, three tasks to complete. You've got to complete the comprehension questions, you've got to complete the table on whether Cromwell should be remembered positively or negatively, and then you've got to write a letter to Boris Johnson, either requesting that the statue stays up or that the statue of Cromwell comes down. They all need to be handed in via Google Classroom before Friday. If you've got any questions, put them on Google Classroom, or you can email me, and my email address is at the bottom. Okay, best of luck with that. I look forward to marking your work on Friday. This will probably be the last chance that I get to speak to you, although, like I said, I might put some lessons on this channel. So if you want to subscribe so that you get a notification over the holidays, then that would be great. It's been an absolute pleasure working in this way over the last couple of weeks, and I cannot wait to see you all again in September. Have a great summer. Bye-bye.